How many of you had gone through the note about the talk what it is? Okay, at least half of you. Okay, good. Yeah, so we'll talk about that. So that's about me. I think you come in the recording. So some prerequisites, like the other assumptions that I made. Are you all aware of the basic function FP principles? Probably the first few days what you learned. Familiarity with the Haskell syntax. I think in the previous talk we have seen some types being defined, something like that, okay. And curiosity or breaking of the initial shell. For example, how many of you tried, started using probably map, filter, flat maps, all those, you know, avoided loops, but then stopped right there, okay. And trying to go understand what is next, right? So if you already understood, then probably it's not needed. But if you are in that stage, I think it might help. So let's talk about M. I think whoever has gone to the notes knows what it is. Yeah, it's monads, but we'll talk through it. We'll talk about monads via, we'll go to that route via functors and applicators or applicative. So I don't intend to present any mathematical definitions because that's there all over the documentations, internet. So this is about, I want to share about how I tried to understand what they are and probably what I thought, you know, I didn't find an explanation like that anywhere else. So if there are experts here, probably that if there are anything missing, let me know. But we'll understand it in a slightly different way. So but initially the first principles, right? So there is only one principle that's all about the functions, like Mars solution is a function. So let's go through some transformations. So I'll take an example, like if you have a user and find an user name, right? So that's some Haskell code, like essentially you get name from the user, name of a user. But what if you have to do for a bunch of users, right? So you have a list of users, you want to get those users' name. Can you still use the same function? So I think you nodded, no, yeah. But what is the solution? Sorry? Stream, yeah, in Java, you'll do that. Stream and what do you do next is what I'm asking, like you convert a stream and then. Okay, so essentially the question is use another function. So most of the answer is use a function. So it's using another function. And that's fmap in Haskell. So you give this function, give the list of users, and you get a list of names, right? That's, all of you would have done it. Now comes the different part. So what does fmap do in this case? Can any of you explain? What does it do? Exactly. That's how we learned it first. That is, apply this function to each element of that list of users, right? And you get the name. Fine, it kind of very easy to understand, goes well with what we have been doing until now. But is there any other way to look at it? Yeah, that, okay, so again, the thought process is, you have this function which works on the individual element, so you take out from the container, apply this, and then, okay, any other way of thinking through it? Let's see whether we have something. So let's move that to the side. Think about this. So you have this original fmap down here, and you, can you convert that onto a function which you can apply it on list of users? So essentially, if you pass only one first parameter, it's like you lift a function which works on individual user and gives the individual name. You lift that function to something which works on the list of users to list of them. So this if you start understanding this in this way, then we can nicely graduate to the next two levels and reach, understand what the one of the property or the core property of the monad. Does it make sense? Yeah. Exactly. So the way we look at it is, yeah, all I need is functions for solving it. So I need a function which will take in a list of users and give me a list of names. Now, how do I create that function? So you to fmap, you pass your ordinary function which works on user and gives a name, and it gives you another function which works on a list of users and list of names. So that's a key difference. I mean, it's at the end of the day, it does the same thing, but the way you understand, I mean, this is one of the ways to understand. That's another way. Yeah. That's more easy. That's more, the first thing how you understand is that. But then you, in fact, if you are doing Scala or Java, probably you understand on that. Then you come to Haskell and apply only partial, do a partial application, then you realize, yeah, what I'm getting is another function if I don't apply the other two, right? So now we come to, let's look at some circles and squares. No. So we have a thing which is represented here using that yellow circle. And we have something which holds that thing. It's a container, it's a context which holds that thing around. And this thing has a function which takes in two normal values, taking a normal circle and converts it to a square. And it gives you another function which will take in a circle which is embedded in a square and then gives you a square, I mean, yeah, green square embedded in a black square, whatever. So this is what we saw. So this is fmap. So that this was a list, in our case, list contained a user, and we had a function which user and gave a name. So we gave it to fmap. Fmap gave you another function which takes a list of user and a list of. Does it make sense? Usually, yeah. Exactly. Yeah. It gave name of users. So this, the blue color is fmap. Yeah, I mean fmap, what is fmap taking? Fmap is taking this function, user to name, and it gave you another function. This function is name of users. It's called name of users. The top, yeah, which takes in a, yeah. It's, so in this way, it's generic, like, you know, it's that user was a specific example. It could be anything, yeah. So then that contain, if that means if a container has the has a function, in this case, it's named fmap, which takes in normal function, which operates on the constituents and gives you back a wrapped, you know, a function which takes in the wrapped entities. Okay, this is fmap. Similar principle you can apply. So next one we'll see. So in this case, it's a different function. So now it takes in a function which is wrapped in the same context. And it gives you the same thing. Right? If you think about the previous example, it's like assume you had a list which contained the function user to name. Now that's all you had. Now, but I want to operate on list of users and give me list of names. So this is what that does, and that's the applicative I don't know what to call it, AP or that we are looking symbol greater than equal than in Haskell. I have an example coming up. So these examples are all combinations, like you do a first a map, and then you end up in a situation where you have a function in a container and you need to apply that. So that's what typically. Is that clear? All right. So now go to the next one. So this again, it's another function. So here, now, so what is the input? Input is a normal stuff. In this, we take the same example, it's a user, but it gives you a list of names. Let's say the user has multiple names or first name and last name or alias, something like that. Let's assume that the user has multiple names. Can you guess what's the function that it gives out? What's the output? It's not been changing for the last couple of slides, right? I mean, it's the same. So that's only the input which changes. And this is essentially your variation of bind, because I tweaked the parameters around the bind to have the story weaved in. So, but the actual function is that, right? Sorry. So these are the three things. So first, you have a function which takes in the normal user to name and gives you back another function which runs on list of users to list of name. The second is your input is a list which contained a function user to name, and you get the same function output. The third is you have a function which takes a user, gives a list of names, but then the output is you have a list of users and list of names. Right? The list, if you are using Scala, this is the flat map. All right, so now we look at it. So you have, this is the first one, so you have a fmap or less than dollar greater than in Haskell, takes a function, gives that, and then there is another property where I think Tony had that type if you attend the session, like if you give a type A, container of B, you replace B with A and use the input. So that's the second one. If these two functions are the, these two functions are defined, it's a functor. So you can, for understanding purposes, you can ignore the second part. Like the one which is allow use to map is a functor. Now we'll expand on, we'll bring the other one. It's kind of tilted. So you have a applicative stuff, that function or AP function. And you have a way to create that container. Now something you give, in the same example, you give A and you get a list of A. You give A, you get a maybe of A. Or you have a way to create it. It's called pure. So this is applicative function. And the somebody, some entity which has all these functions, and then comes our bind or flat map operation. It has a return which is same as pure. Okay, everything you would have seen, there are other laws that these have to satisfy. There are other various functions which are defined on these type classes. But this is the code. So the point I wanted to convey is another way of understanding is like how, what are kind of function transformations it can do, like take A to B gives me a function which works on, let's say, MA to MB. Takes M of A to B and gives me back a function M of A to M of B. Take a function A to M of B and then transform that to another function which works, which takes in MA and gives MB. So that's the three stages. Is that complicated? Like, how is it? Just following. Anything in Monad is not completed without talking about bind or what exactly it's used for. So let's look at this. So this is the function which I defined, where you take the first parameter as a function, right? If you do a partial application, you get another function. But actual bind operation syntax is different one. The first parameter is the actual container, like so in this case, it will be a list of users. And second is a function, and third list of names. So what bind enables is, it takes the value out of that container and then creates a second one out of it. So you can chain multiple, let's say if you have maybe, you can chain multiple maybe, multiple list or whatever that container is. But one condition, the container has to be same. You can chain maybes. You cannot chain maybe versus list, or it has to be list, or it has to be, in this example, it has to be always a black square. You can't do anything else. That's what you can chain. And other significant stuff, if some of you have already reached this stage, other things are monad transformer. That is when, let's say you have to chain, compose multiple types of monads. So I'm not going to talk about that, probably the next stuff that you need to even read about and try doing it. All right, so this is the summary. So this kind of half of the talk, actually. I could have just shown this one slide, but I wanted to build this out gradually. So this shows everything. So you have the first one, which is functor. Second one, applicative, and third is a monad, oh, plus other laws, of course. I'll just leave it for a few seconds. Any questions? You can just see this, and if any of the things are not clear or some things are confusing, let me know. And there is a, I think there is a problem in one of the images. No? So, yeah, maybe I will correct it. Exactly. Yeah, that's one property. Yes, output remains same. It just was what. So these three are the different things. The input, the kind of inputs that it takes. Fine. All right. So we'll look at some examples. Again, examples of the existing monads. One is maybe. How many of you used maybe or Scala is option or option? Java it's optional, is it? Or Java is also option? Optional. Okay. Yeah. So let's look at a similar example. Let's say we want to create a greeting for a user based on a user's alias. Let's say it's used in an environment where you want to reveal the user's name. So alias may or may not have been configured. So then so in this case, you are mapping a function. Given an alias, it will say hello. Given a name, hello John, hello John, hello XYZ, hello XYZ. Does it make sense? Like it's taking the function, and then giving the alias. An alias is a maybe string. Now, we can do the same using applicative. So this I would like to explain. So here, so if you see the first part, that is, it's mapping this append operation plus plus operator on just of a hello. Like hello is your constant string that you want to be prefixing with, right? So in this, what you have is, you have a just which contains a function. If it takes one more string, then it will give you that hello space, that string. Whatever that, which takes an alias. So now you are in a situation where you have a function inside a maybe, right? So if you have a function inside a maybe, what you can do is the second one, right? That's a scenario where you have a function inside a maybe. So you need to use the AP function. So that's what is that less than, greater than, star, and you give the alias and you have the same output over here. It's a function. It could be function which could return another function. So it could be any kind of number, but it has to be A to B or A to A, whatever. It has to be a function. Correct. It box could be anything. It could be list. It could be maybe. It could be anything else. Yeah, correct. Yeah, exactly, yes, correct, yeah. Correct. Correct. Plus plus is a two argument, okay, everything is a one single argument function in Haskell, right? But you can understand it, okay, it was a two argument function, but I applied only one. So it gave me another function which takes the next argument whenever it's available and it'll give the value. Okay. Sure. So the black box in this case is maybe, okay? So when you fmap plus plus over a value or just hello, what you get is a maybe which contains a function which takes the actual user's alias and give you back the string hello username or hello user alias, right? So this, so black box is maybe, that's a function which takes a string and another string. In that case, the types are same, like both are string. Is that clear? Okay. All right, now the next one. So this again, faked an example in this case to just to show follow the same user, same model, like user and the name. So let's say in this case, the user has a invalid character, like your system cannot support certain characters in the alias, like I want to find out what those characters are. So in this case, you have a function, so here, and it returns you a maybe of an int, that it may, such characters may exist or may not exist. If it exists, it will give you just whatever number, 2, 3. I know that you can do it using just 0, but let's ignore 0 for this part. If no invalid character exists, it will be none, right? So in that case, how you get that is, okay, so you are having alias, wiping it through that particular function. So it will take the string and it will give that maybe of an int. So finally your end result is maybe. It's like you're having a maybe string, but then you're getting a maybe of int. The point to note here is both are maybes. So maybe that means both are black boxes. Let's say yellow was a string and green is a int, then only that yellow changed to green. All right, so it's similar example for the list. I think I'll glance through it or I'll just leave it for a few seconds if you want to read the types. Yeah. Yeah, I want to greet only if that person has an alias configured. Yeah, so if depending on a person, my greeting, I would have called it greeting or whatever it is, greeting would be just the actual string which I want to greet with, or it may be none. Correct. So what I'm passing to fmap, this is a function which takes a string, returns another string. Like it just prefixes hello and gives back the string. Now, I want to convert that function to the one which works on maybes. See, my function over here, this s over here, it's a string, and it gives back another string. I want to convert this function to works on maybes, because what I have is maybe. My alias is a maybe string, not a string. If alias was a string, I could have directly used this function. I don't need to fmap. Got it? It's not, so because I simulated the scenario where you will have a function inside a maybe. So that's why that fmap is over there, where you are expecting a value out of a function, but if you don't pass all the required parameters, then you do partially apply, what you get is a function. And going forward, we'll talk about where you have an entire list of functions, how you sequence through all those things, all those kind of things. So that's a perfectly valid scenario in which you end up having functions embedded inside those contexts. And we are going to talk about state monads, right? So that essentially it is, like it has, it doesn't hold a value. So that's why when we looked at that yellow thing, it's a value, it's a, or a expression, or a, you know, it's some kind of a computation that we could do. And the box is a context or a container. Yeah, I mean, treat like a box. Fine. So we're kind of halfway. So let's go through the. Would you like to see some code? Okay. So this is a typical problem we have seen in these conferences before, and some interview problems and all those things, right? So I have kind of simplified it, and let's look at that and see how do we solve that using three different ways. So we'll take you through that. So the first one. Okay. So it's a rover landed in a rectangular plateau. It understands two commands, probably move and turn, and move is, let's say, one step, very simple, turn left or right. And after each command or set of commands, if you're sending like multiple at the same time, it responds back with which position the rover is in, like, and assume that starting position is always 0, 0 on the top left or whatever it is, right? And the direction it is facing. And now we need to build a simulator to try this out. And I know the original problem has a bound, like it knows like here are the coordinates, and then it should, if it go try to go outside of it, we should indicate an error and all those things. For simplicity's sake, let's say it's infinitely, you know, flat and it never ends, like you can go as much as possible, right? So do you want to see a Java implementation for this? No? Okay, I'll just show. Let me ask another question. You want to see now or at the end? Like after going, after the end? Okay, I have this slide in both places. Okay, good. So let's defer it to the end. So we look at the basic implementation. So what are the types here? Why do you think the types are, like, you know the problem domain now, like? Are they type? Okay. Position, somebody said, and the command is a type, like command holds something, but it's a type. It, once you start defining it, there are others one will come in. Like for example, you need which direction it is facing. So position contains direction, but forget that, high level, higher level we'll see now. And the functions are probably operate, like I don't move and turn, I wanted to have a common word like operate, right? And the implementation is just this, right? It's like you give a current position, you start with 0, 0, and probably some direction facing north, south, whatever it is, and a command, and you get a new position. That's all it is. So it's one function which takes this. Of course, you'll have the type definition for others and all those things. Do you think that's what it is? It could be this simple? Let's see. So we'll have to make it a little faster. So this is the first one, right? So there are, why it didn't, sorry. All right, so let's look at this now. So the light is kind of not readable. Is it readable at least? Sorry? Frankly, I don't know how to change. Yeah, I'll increase the font further. Okay. Decent? Okay, cool. So we have some type definitions over here. Command is move. In this case, you can move multiple steps, but we'll always use one as a value. Turn, and turn has like left or right. Position has X, Y, some direction. Direction is north, south, east or west, right? So these are the types. So this kind of your modeling kind of your domain. So this is what it is. I don't have anything for the rover. So rover doesn't do anything. And I have the move function, which actually takes the position, how much to move, and gives a new position. Turn, similarly, there's an implementation for turn, blah, blah, blah. So what is of interest is this operate. So given a position and a command, it gives a new position. So if the command is move and the corresponding distance, we'll call the move function. Turn and what direction to turn, call the turn function. If it gives and something, there's an undefined over there. If it's something else, you just retain the current position. I don't understand what you're saying. Is this clear? So now the thing is, this works for one command, right? So how do you will send something like, let's say commands are left turn, R, sorry, L for left turn, R for right turn, MMM. We could give L, MMM, RRR, MMM, like 20 different characters. So it's a series of commands. So that's where the work is. So let's look at this. I kind of weirdly named as option one, I should have changed it. But anyway, so you enter the get the command, and then what does this do? Like, it converts a string to a corresponding command, and you're actually folding. We use fold. Okay. So essentially it takes, you have an initial value, fold L, so the initial value becomes your left side argument. You have a two argument function, so which takes the initial value, takes the first from the left side, applies it, gets the value, updates the value, and then take the next one and keeps on going like that, right? So, and you have a result at the end of the day, right? And then we are recursing it, so that when you run it, like it will keep on, and this is like a console application, so it will keep on asking for what is the command that you need for. So in this case, the point to note is there is no rover type as such, it's only position, command, and other things. And every time you need to keep, you are managing the position. Like every time you call the function, you get your next position. So you need to keep track of it because you need to pass it to the next level, and that's what fold does it for you. So you are explicitly using fold to ensure that you are managing the state yourself, right? So we'll see this. So I'm just calling it. So it will say LMMR. So just printing out what are the commands. So like turn left, turn left turn, move one, turn right turn. And your final position is equal to x equal to minus 2, whatever it is, right? So now we'll reverse it so that it goes back to the original one. So RMML, it goes back to the original one. So it's keeping that state. It's not always starting from zero. Let's say in this, you need to create a map of intermediate positions. Can you do that? Or something that you think about, like, I don't want the last position alone. I want to know the path which trace. Like first it went to x became minus 1, then it went to minus 2, then it changed. So I want the position of individual. Let's say you need to plot a graph. Like this. So that's something you need to see. So getting back to the slide. All right. So we told that there is no type rover, right? So now think about the types that you bring in. So you're operating a rover. So probably you need a type called rover with position as a type parameter. Do you think that makes sense? Let's see. So your position is the only state for now. So you are holding a position. You need a container that position. So the types would be like, let's say rover M, calling it as rover M, position, and position command, the function is run rover. So that's what it is. So it's nothing much. Only thing is earlier we were using only position, so now we have a rover which contains a position in it. So that's the current rover, and you get the new rover. And it could have other static, non-changing, you know, aspects of the rover which can show that in over here. So that doesn't change, only the position changes. You want to see this, or we'll go to the next one, state. Next one? Okay, I'll show you this, but there's a reason. Okay, so this is what it is. So now, I want to see how can I not do fold? Okay, and how do I avoid managing that, intermediate positions, I know the fold does it for us, but I want to avoid that. I was exploring a solution, then I thought I'll make rover a mod. I was learning monads, I thought I'll make rover a monad. Okay, so this is that attempt. So I'll just glance through it. So if it is to be monad, you need to make it as an instance of various type classes like functor, applicative, and monad, and all those functions are defined. But the point which I wanted to convey is when I did that, then finally made it work, what happened is, we'll just go through this. So same as last time, you get a command to run, and they had to create this intermediate stuff called position function. So what this is, if you see the run rover, position, command, and position. So when I map it over this command to run, this becomes a list of this one exactly, position to position. So all I had in that list was not list of rover M's. It was a list of functions, and function was given a current position, given new position. I don't have a command in there because the command will be different for each command is different. So you cannot have a standard one. For every, you partially applied a command, you get a function, given a position, another position. So this position function, so I'm not using that rover M at all. I mean, it's okay, it's like given the current rover, give me a new rover, or given a current position, give a new position. So this led to something new. That means probably in these scenarios where you have to travel the state, it's not that I don't hold that yellow thing is not position. Probably it should be a function. Because that's what is coming out over here. Like ultimately you are translating that to a list of functions and then working on it. So probably originally what if it had function? So that's I know that I just hold bypass that code walkthrough and demo, but the core part was about this. Like that position function, pause functions was a list of position to position. So this gave a clue that these are those three lines of code. Like run rover is position, command to run, and when we do this, you get a rover position to current position. So what it means is this one is a function. It's no longer 10 minutes, right? Yeah, it's no longer a value as such, it's a function. And that's state monad. Of course, it's factually incorrect. It's not, there is a specific definition for that function, you see that. But in general, it's a function. So it's a context which holds a function, right? Now what exactly that function is, it's of this format, where you have a state and you pass in a state, and then you get a tuple of the result of that particular computation and a state, and a new state, right? If I map it to the current one, current problem, it's like, okay, change it to rover S. So I have I'll give a rover with a position. It will give me, for that computation, what is the position, and it will give me an updated rover with position as one of the state and other state probably remaining as it is. And it has got all those functions over there, what we talked about, like fmap, ap, this thing, one bunch of stuff. So since we are in C for the completion stake, these are the tools that are available. Like once you have this function, you can use these functions on the monad to either to get a final, to get hold of contained value, like run state gives you back that function, whatever is wrapped, but you can invoke it and get the value. And exec state will give you a function, it gives only the final state, you don't care about the result. And eval is, you don't care about the state, you get only the result. This is just for the completion sake. Right, so this is fun. And so let's go through the, I'll mirror it again, and you have it here. So this is over this, right? Okay, so so we look at run rover, right? Run rover takes a command and a rover and gives back a position and another rover, right? So look at this part. Rover S gives rover position rover S. This is exactly matching your syntax of state S arrow A and S. So this is what probably we need to wrap it inside a state monad. So you have that rover data state, rover S and position, because this is the state and this is the value. So rover S gives back position and rover S. So this is your rover data is your state. It's a type that holds the state on it. And this rover S itself is like, okay, I know that it's a position. That's only one at this point it exists. Now if we go to the implementation of it, the same thing, you get a new line, you get the command, and here you see fmap to rover command to run. So what this does is, I have a command and I'm giving it to rover. So it gives me the state monad. Like state is a like a constructor function kind of thing where you pass the, your wrapped mod, run rover command will give you this rover to position rovers. Pass it to state, you get a state monad. So you get a rover data. So this will give you list of commands to list of rover data. Okay. And you're sequencing over that. The sequence implementation in state monads. So what sequence does is you have a list of monads, list of rover data. Sequence will give you rover data which contains list of your positions or list of the result types. Or rather, it contains a function if you which on which if you call exec state or run state or eval state, you will get that value. So that's exactly what you are doing here. And finally, you are doing a run state. So run state gives you a function s equals s arrow AAS. So we are passing that rover function and passing the initial rover with an initial position. And this gives the tuple position and rovers. And with the sequence magic, you know what this positions is? These are all the intermediate position that it went through. I'll show you that. And this is your final state. So we are printing the intermediate position and the final one. So this is, in fact, it's not, it's just again syntactical stuff like sequence implementation. If you go, it internally uses a fold. So it's just that at your level, you don't, you think it's magic. Like you don't write it. So we'll show this demo another 4 minutes. So I need to change this. Is rover using the state monad. All right. See that. Press Control C. Okay, we'll give the same command, LLMMR. So now we have, at least we have the same result as last time, and this time it has printed the intermediate position. So the default position is 00 north. So first it said turn left, so it became west, 00 west. Then it moved one step, so it x is minus 1, then moved another step, x is minus 2, then again took right. Pointing back to north, sorry, yeah, right, pointing back to north. So that's what is minus, I thought it was a bug. it's not. And it gave the final position over here. So now let's reverse it, R, MM, L. So this again, initial was minus 2, 0. Okay, after turning left, it became east, then minus 1, then 0, then towards, then again a left turn, it became north. So it kind of came back to original position. So essentially, it's here. So the key point is the container, the box, or the monad, whatever that entity holds a specific function which takes in a state and gives a value in another state. And you can sequence such objects which will actually run through the entire computation given an initial state. And it will give you'll get all the intermediate results and the final state that you need. So that's pretty much what I wanted to show. Any questions? Ah, you want to see the Java, I'm sorry. That's cool. Just have to change this display property.
Hello. Time.
Just a second. Okay, Java. See ya. But Eclipse changing the font is going to be. Between the, while it's coming up, yeah. Any questions?
Yeah, any questions until then?
Currently my Haskelling is learning and hobby. I did O for like 15 years. So then Scala for last, I think I started doing Scala like 4 or 5 years back. We don't get to use Haskell at job. Yeah. But it's, But until now, I'm still struggling to break out of that initial shell and to see whether do we really, when we solve a real world problem, do we need to implement these monads ourselves, like some containers ourselves? That's what I thought. Like for Rover, okay, I'll represent it as a monad. But there again, okay, there's something called state monad, so you can use that and that helps actually. So I haven't still reached there, probably by next year or something. So this is, so this implementation has, it has like four plus eight classes, which are coordinates and probably a couple of power. Yeah, it's a bunch of stuff. It's there in GitHub, I have the link. I wrote this probably in 2009 or 10. At that time, this was the best solution that I could write in Java.
You are not actually making the monad kind of thing, right? So
no. This is pure O. Okay. I mean, and so this actually did it in 2009, and that time I thought this is the best solution anybody can give, and this is best and compact.
Even if a senior person is recommending it and you can sort of do a small POC project, you would still not be allowed to use Haskell at work.
See, it all depends on where you are. You are running a, let's say you have five employees in your company and you want to do that as a group, yes, you can. But if you are in a 350 member team and training, I mean, to me, I still feel bringing folks on board and start writing production code in Haskell is extremely difficult, and you probably need a different kind of people and team in order to do that in a larger scale. So, but you can still attempt smaller stuff. And to me, I have talked tomorrow. So what I have experienced is, you apply this basic, like don't worry about monads, and apply these basic principles probably about no mutable state, and about writing as much as writing pure functions, and then keep all your impurity and that kind of stuff, probably around 10% of your implementation, that itself will give you a tremendous difference in how you build things. And that's probably what I'll be talking about tomorrow.
I think Michael had a talk on what you're facing on how to break through at your work. Michael Snowman has some great insights on that, especially around how to build your community in larger enterprises and how to change the conversation from productivity and lines of code to actually maintainability, which is the language that your management would understand. You tell them, this is cool, we'll use monads, they'll show you the door and say, get out of here. And go write your unit tests or something.
Not only applicable, but at least my experience is that folks are very receptive. And again, now a lot of mainstream like Java has all this, probably it doesn't have monads as it, but like all the basic constructs, that's good enough to make a huge difference is what I have observed. But the pitfall there is, you can still write Java code. So that's the pitfall. So that, and that requires developer discipline. Yeah, I mean, that's a bunch of issues around there, but yeah. That's true. In fact, the problem there are numerous ways to do one thing, and that's always an issue, always a problem. I mean, things are simple if you have one way to do certain things.
Anyway. I'm going to ask you about that tomorrow's talk.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, especially when how it relates to Scala. Numerous ways of doing the same thing in Scala.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. That's why, right. In Scala also you can write Java code. So.
Right. Thank you so much. Thank you. This is a great talk.
Thank you.